Good morning, good morning. It's so good to see everyone today. It may not be a beautiful day yet, but I think it's going to be outside. But it's definitely a beautiful day inside to gather together and worship the Lord. Amen. A couple of announcements. Before we have an announcement, last night we had our Valentine's banquet. If you missed it, it was great. It was beautifully decorated, lots of beautiful tables. And I have a thank you card from the Rays. It says, thank you, friendship family, for last night and loving one another as God commands. So many beautiful tables, delicious desserts, last minute music requests, rolls requests, can opener requests, and willing service for the Lord. When God is within it, it cannot fail. Love the Rays. And we thank the Rays for organizing that and preparing the food. Can we sit for him? Thank you so much. Well, as you see, we have Brother Danny Wyatt with us again. You can give him a hand if you want to. He's going to be with us this morning and tonight. And tonight we are going to have a music service at 6 p.m. if you want to join us. And if you would like to participate, if you have a song to share, or if you want to come up here and do some karate, or any talent, just let me know after church, and we'll make sure we can put you in the lineup. We'd love to have you. We have choir practice on Wednesday nights at 7 and Sunday mornings at 9, but we do have a walk-up choir here at Friendship, so if you like singing in the choir, you can come. If you're a visitor, just come up here and join us. And I see some friends coming in. How y'all doing? There's a deacon meeting today at 4:30. Ladies book club meeting this month on February 14th and the 28th at the home of Orme Layton at 9 a.m. And there's also a couple more announcements. Monthly business meeting will be this Wednesday night, the 15th. And the transition team meeting has been rescheduled for the 19th at 4:30. And finally, last but not least, oh, there's two more. WOM will meet next Sunday, February 19th, with the topic of focus on WMU Day at 4:30. And then if you saw the boxes up here, there's a World Hunger Day in conjunction with WOM request a one-day-only canned food drive next Sunday, February 19th, men versus women. And Tanya said if you just want to give money, you can give it to her. And I guess you need to mark man or woman on the money. What if the man gives the woman the money to give to you? Who gets the credit? Thank you in advance for participating in that. All right, how about we open this morning with some scripture? I'm going to read from 1 Chronicles 16, verses 10 through 12. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. The Lord is glorified in his people's praise and worship, and there was rejoicing on that momentous day in God's city. Let us pray this morning. Heavenly Father, how we rejoice in you, because you are good and your grace and mercy endures forever. We give you thanks and glory in your holy name, for your glory reaches the heavens and fills our hearts with great gladness and joy. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to pay the penalty for our sins. Thank you that he is with us at all times and that he will return in great glory and majesty, for which we worship and praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. All right, speaking of the walk-up choir, if you'd like to sing with us in the choir, you can come on up. These are congregational hymns, so you can sing from your seat as well. So come on up and join us this morning.
Thank you.
Next, we're going to sing page 361. We have heard the joyful sounds he's saved. A couple of vocals going to help us in the choir.
Thank you.
This morning, we're going to start a new worship segment called Children's Moment. So if you are planning to go to Children's Church, if you will join us right here on these stairs in front of Brother Tim, and we're just going to have a short moment together, then you're going to go to Children's Church. So come on down and follow the leader. Come on up and join us. There may be a prize. There may be a prize. There is a prize. There is a prize. What a great looking group. How are y'all doing? Doing good? Okay. How many knows what this is? What is this? A present. Or what else would we call it? Like a birthday gift. Exactly. It's a gift. Who do you think this gift is for? It's for one of you guys. But let me tell you something. Do you know that a gift is also... we call it a talent. You know what a talent is? Like maybe a lot of people think a talent, like if you can sing or play an instrument, or maybe if you or if you're good at drawing. But your talent could also be, you might be good at math, might be your talent. Or you know what's a talent too? Can you roll your tongue? Yeah, that's a talent. Everyone can't do that. Can you do this? Yeah. Well, guess what? Everyone can't. Brother Tim? Well, listen, the talent is a gift that God gives us, and it's a gift that we should give back to God, just like we do when we serve up here with our talents in music, and people serve with their talents and putting the screens together, making slides, and typing in the bulletins. Those are all talents. And the Bible tells us, whatever you do work, Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from what Lord as a reward in the Lord Christ you are serving. So what that means is if I give this present, Layla, come here. I'm going to give you this gift. So that's one gift. But if you give it back to me, now let's open it. Come on. Yeah. Let's open it up. If we give our gifts back to God, guess what he'll do? He will multiply those gifts so that everyone has a gift. And you can share your gifts with everyone. So one gift becomes many. All right? You guys can have those. So we're going to say a prayer, and then you guys are going to go out this door right here down to Children's Church. Yeah, you can all have one. All right, can we pray together? All right. Dear Jesus, thank you for the gifts that you give us, that we may be able to use them for you. Thank you for the gift of your son Jesus that you gave, that he came and died on the cross for all of our sins. We praise you. We thank you for these little lives. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yeah, they're yours. We take the extra ones too. They may need to trade some. Sing with us. Trust and obey this morning.
When we walk.
Make sure if you see a visitor, tell them they're welcome this morning. ushers are coming up front for our worship and giving this morning. Y'all sure do love shake hands, talk to each other.
Amen.
That's a good thing.
Yeah.
Many highways, just drifted along on any old wind that blows. I've set so many goals, but never made them, because your good work wasn't in them, I suppose. I've struggled many years to seek my fortune. Seems every step I took, I fell back to. Till one day spoke unto me. He said, I've got some things that I want you to do. Just put away your worldly ambitions. Give up and let your heart my cross, and then you follow me, and I'll make you one. since that day I had my talk with Jesus. He's shown me many things I never knew. He's given me so much, I just keep asking, is there anything that I can do for you? Just put away your worldly ambitions. Give up and let your heart be free. You take up my cross and then you follow me, and I'll make you what I want you to be. You take up my cross and then you follow me, and I'll make you what I want you to be.
Let's welcome our guest speaker this morning, Brother Danny Wyatt, and give another hand.
Amen. You glad to be in God's house this morning? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. What a blessed morning we've had already. Thank you, Brother Jameson, for that song service. And I tell you what, I've said it many times before, I'll say it again. If that don't light your fire, your wood's wet. Amen. Some of us need to just understand who Jesus is and what he's done. And if you do this morning, then praise the Lord. We've got a reason to worship him today. And I'm thankful for salvation. I'm thankful that I'm saved. Amen. Last week we preached on the Lord's grace. Amen. I'm glad I've got God's grace this morning. If it wasn't for God's grace, Ellis, I wouldn't be standing here, amen. I tell you, God is just so good, amen. You'd rather be here in the best jail in St. Clair County? Raise your hand. Amen, amen. What a place. You can take your hand down now, thank you, amen. We're glad you're here too, amen. there's just some things we want to ask you to continue to be in prayer for this morning. Continue to pray for Brother Hugh's wife. She's recovering. And continue to pray for my wife. She had her back block Monday. It went really good. Of course, we know that those take a couple of weeks to settle in and get to working. But we know that God's in control. And he's not up there wringing his hands wondering what he's going to do. Amen. He already knows. We just need to be obedient and wait and trust. And I know it's easy to say wait and trust and be patient when you ain't the one hurting. But God is good all the time. Amen. And I tell you what, when I say God is good, I want you to say all the time. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time?
God is good.
That's what I'm talking about. Amen. Give the Lord a big hand of praise this morning. He's worthy. Yes, he is. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. This morning, I want to come to you from a passage of Scripture in the book of Luke, chapter 15. If you have your Bibles, would you turn there with us this morning? So good to see so many people here this morning. Some folks we know, some folks you're just a friend I hadn't met yet. Amen. But it's good to see everybody in God's house this morning. So thankful for the Lord and his mercy and grace. Luke chapter 15 and verses 11 through 32, we read about a familiar story. And I wrestle with whether or not to read the whole story this morning, but I think I need to because many of us know it, some may not. So I just want to make sure everybody is on the same page. Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. Can you stand with us together for the reverence of the reading of God's Word? And then pray for me this morning that we just be and say and do what God would have us to say and do. Verse 11, and he, being Jesus, said, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said unto his father, Give me the portion of the goods that falleth to me, and he divided unto him his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself unto a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed his swine. And he would have fain filled his belly with the husk that the white swine did eat, and no man gave to him. And when he came to himself, he said, How many hired servants of my father's house have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father's house, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. Now, but when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And when the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said unto his servants, Bring forth the best robe and put on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again, and he was lost and is found, and he began to be merry. Now, his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard the music and dancing. And he called to one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, Thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and entreated him. And he answered and said to his father, Lo, these many years I do serve thee, neither transgressed I at any of thy commandments, and yet thou hast never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, that has devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all thy have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Father, thank you for this parable. Thank you, Lord, that we get a glimpse of your heart toward us. Father, we get a glimpse of your heart toward us. And we thank you, Father, for the many parables that Jesus told. But Father, this one, let it speak to our hearts and our minds this morning. There be a heart here that's away from you, Father. Would you just please entreat them, Father, to come in and enter into a relationship with you. Because, Lord, that's why you died, and that's why you rose again, was for a relationship. We thank you and we praise you, Father, for who you are, what you've done, and, Father, just for the great blessings that we enjoy this morning, the gift of grace and the gift of salvation because of your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. The parable known as the prodigal son is one of the most famous Jesus ever told. It's the last of three parables told in Luke chapter 15, highlighting how God seeks sinners, and an overzealous emphasis has been placed on the prodigal son, which has led to the cultural naming of the parable. But we will see, Jesus intended the climax of the parable to be with the second son. Amen. Now, based on the Mosaic law, the oldest son would be set to inherit 2/3 of his father's estate, and the younger son would be set to inherit 1/3 of his father's estate. And during that time, people held honor in high esteem. Every son was expected to honor his father and respectably carry his name. The son was not merely seen as an individual, but an extension of the father and the entire family. So in a sense, the honor rested upon the shoulders of the sons. Now, the father's inheritance would usually go beyond money. It would go toward livestock. It would go toward land. And so, and usually that the inheritance wouldn't be divided up until after the father had died. So when the young man, the younger son, came to his father and said, "I want you to give me the portion that falls to me," he was in essence saying to his father, "I wish you were dead." How would we react if one of our children came and said that to us? Maybe your child has said that to you. Just know that you're not the first one that ever had to undergo something like this. And next, the father brought further dishonor on his son when he cashed his share of the inheritance in, when he liquidated his assets. See, back then, what would happen was when the sons would come of age, they would start being put in control over their assets, and the things that they were going to have inherit, like livestock and land and things, it belonged to the whole family. And they were going to manage that and build upon the family's future. And the father would receive the profits of that until he died. So when he took and he liquidated all of his assets, he basically took one third of his father's income and did away with it. Now, good gracious, what a selfish young man he was. And even more worse than this, the rejection of the father was the rejection of his whole entire family, of his lineage, of his generational care, of his inheritance. The son was expected to use that and build upon it, but he just counted it as nothing, liquidated it, and walked off. Now, we need to understand who Jesus is talking to in the 15th chapter of Luke here. Notice in chapter 15, verse 1, "Then drew near to him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him, and the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners, and he eateth with them." So Jesus' audience was publicans and sinners and Pharisees. The social outcast of the day and the religious elite. They were there. They were present. They were listening to this story. So after the son liquidates his second, one-third of his father's income, he went into a foreign country and used it for sinful, self-indulgent living. How many of us have been selfish and self-indulgent? Thank you for your honesty, amen. Selfish and self-indulgent. But the money ran out in verses 14 through 16. In a desperate attempt to survive, the son took his services, offered his services to one of the citizens of that country, and then he was given a job feeding swine. Now, this had a very big implication to the Jews. They didn't want anything to do with pigs. Amen? Now, I know we just observed Groundhog Day. I will have you know that the only groundhog that I observe is sausage. Amen? That's the only groundhog that I observe. But the Jews would not have anything to do with pigs because they were listed as unclean, Deuteronomy chapter 14 and verse 8. So the average Jew wanted nothing to do with them. And while he fed these pigs, the son desired to eat their food because no man was giving him anything. At this point, in the eyes of the Jews, especially the Pharisees and scribes, the son would become the most defiled human being imaginable, destroyed his his relationship with God, with his people, and his family, and there was no hope of redemption in their legalistic minds. But in his desolate condition, the son came to his senses and realized his father had enough food for him to survive. The son journeyed back to the plant. The son journeyed back home with the plan to ask his father to just take him on as a hired servant, and he'd no longer be a son and be recognized as a son because of his reckless rebellion. Thank God. In verses 20, "And he arose and came to his father's house. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion upon him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him." This son had devoured one-third of his income, told him he wished he was dead, had fed pigs, which was the most bottom-of-the-barrel job you could get. But when the father would get up every morning, he would go out, probably go out of his house, and he would look out, and his eyes would scan the horizons, just waiting to see if that son was anywhere in the vicinity, you know. And then the Bible says when he was a great way off, when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him. Today, I want you to know that no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, you may think you're the most defiled person in this room today. You may think that what you have done can't be forgiven, that you're beyond redemption. Child, I want you to know this, that the Father is scanning the horizon for you today, and He wants to enter into a relationship with you. And even though you're a great way off, the Father sees you and loves you. How He loves us. How He loves us. What goes on is just amazing to me. After everything this son had done to his father and to his family and to his people, the father runs to him. Now, in that day, it was considered indignant for an older man to run. But that father cast off all the social observances of that day, and he ran toward his son. I want you to know today that the Bible says in James chapter 4, draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. That is a promise today. That is 100% acceptance, that if you will draw nigh to God today, He will draw nigh to you. He loves you and wants to enter into that relationship for you. He is seeking you. He is looking for you, and He wants you to be found today. And if you will take one step toward Him, He will run to you. Verses 22 through 24, the father kissed him and gave him three items that were very significant. One, he said, bring the best robe. Not just a robe, but the best robe, and put it on him. Now the robe was only given to honor guests. And he said, bring a ring and put it on him. Now the ring symbolized authority. Sons were given authority by their father, and the ring signified the youngest son had been restored to his place in the family. The father also said, bring some sandals and put them on his feet. The significance of sandals was because servants did not wear sandals. Only people of honor, the sons, wore sandals. In addition to these three items, the father commanded that the fatted calf be killed, which was reserved for special occasions. Teaching Sunday school one time, got down to this point, you know, and I said, well, the point we're fixing to move into, I said, well, now who was not happy to see the prodigal son come home? Little guy raised his hand and said, the fatted calf. He wasn't happy one bit to see the prodigal son come home. Oh, goodness. But then Jesus moves to the crux of the story. In the parable, and the oldest son, his reaction to his brother's return was less than enthusiastic. He stood outside, and he was mad. He wouldn't even go in, but yet the father came out to him. He said, Father, all these years I've stayed with you. I've never disobeyed one of your commandments. I've been faithful. I've been continual. And you never even so much as gave me a kid that I might kill it and have a little party with my friends. But as soon as this thy son, notice he didn't say my brother, notice as soon as this thy son has come home, you've killed for him the fatted calf reserved for people with honor. And I'm not sure exactly how that conversation went, but I'm pretty sure that the father said, I have the authority to give him a robe that signifies honor. I gave him a ring that signifies authority, and I gave him sandals, which signifies he is not a servant. So he was restored to the family, and just like that prodigal son was restored, you can be restored today too. It doesn't matter how far you've gone. People may say you're unredeemable. People may say you've gone too far. You can't outrun the grace of God. It's there. It's waiting for you. Jesus died for you. He wants a relationship with you, and he wants to enter into that relationship. And today you can have it if you will just ask him. Amen. But not only did Jesus die for you, he rose again. If Jesus be not risen for the dead, then my preaching and your faith is vain. We're wasting our time if Jesus is not risen from the dead. But he is alive. He is alive and well. Like that song, Jameson, I serve a risen Savior. He's in my heart today. I know that he is living, no matter what men may say. Hey, listen, he lives. He lives. You know, you ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. My Savior is alive, and he wants you to be alive today. Amen. Moving on to the second son. The second son was less than enthusiastic that his brother came home. And this was this part of the parable Jesus told for the audience that was there, the Pharisees and the scribes, the self-righteous people of the day. Boy, I tell you what, you know, the Pharisees and the scribes, they were rascals, wasn't they? Amen? Did you know that they still exist? Oh, we're getting nervous now. They still exist. They're around. They're in churches all over St. Clair County. Oh, when they're growing up, they went to VBS. They went to Sunday school. They attended every revival their church ever had. They've been baptized. Honey, you can be a church member and be lost and on your way to hell today. Church members are getting saved all the time because they realize that, hey, all the ordinance that they've observed and all the services that they've been in all their life, maybe they thought that they were close to God like this son that stayed home. They thought they were close to the Father, but their hearts are far away because there's no love involved. They're keeping they're doing all the things. They're checking all the boxes. They're doing all the right things, but there is no personal relationship with Jesus. There's no genuine love. And today, we need to check ourselves to see if we fall in that category. Because you might be here every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. You may have gone to VBS. You may have gone to Sunday school. You may have gone to every revival this church has ever run. You might have been baptized. Amen. But let me tell you what. If you've been baptized and do not know the Lord as your personal Savior, all you did was you went down a dry center and you came up a wet center. That's it. The ordinance of baptism is significant of what it's an outward sign of an inward reality. It's telling us, it's basically declaring to the world what has taken place on the inside, and that we die to ourselves. We hold our breath. We go under the water. The water encloses over the top of us, signifying the burial. And then we're raised to the newness of life, which signifies the resurrection. Therefore, we identify with the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and we identify with him. But if that ordinance has been observed without the inward reality, then you need to be saved. Whoa. But I was baptized. Let me tell you something, church. People are going to miss heaven by 18 inches. Did you hear me? People are going to miss heaven by 18 inches from what's in their head to what's in their heart. You might know all the right things in your head, but do you love in your heart? Is Jesus a reality in your heart? Do you know him in the free pardon of sin today? Was there a time that you said to him, Jesus, I'm not even worthy to be called a son of God. I'm a sinner. I need salvation. I need you to come into my heart and cleanse me and wash me of my sin and be my Savior. Can you think of a time that you've ever done that? We need to examine ourselves this morning, lest we fall into the same category as this son that stayed home and seemed to have it all together. But both of these boys were lost in their own way. The prodigal son was lost because of his self-indulgence. The older son was lost in his own self-righteousness. It's easy to point out the sins of others. It's easy to look at somebody and criticize them for what they've done, or to look down upon them for who they are. But let me tell you what the Bible says. Brethren, if any be overtaken in a fault, let you which are spiritual restore such a one. We should be about restoration today. The father in this story was about restoration. I wasn't planning on talking about this, but I'm going to go ahead. Thank you. Amen. It's about restoration. Jesus is about restoration today. We need to be about restoration. Consider him and restore him. Considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. We need to have a spirit of restoration today. We need to have the heart of Jesus. The Father wants a relationship. He wants us to draw into a relationship. Jesus didn't die for religion. Religion was one of the things that crucified him. But he died for a relationship. He wants a personal, intimate relationship. And he rose to seal that relationship. Thank you, Jesus, for your restoration. The Father restored his son. Hey, a robe, a ring, and shoes. Put him right back in his place. Jesus can do that for you. And then he went out and explained to his older son. He not only wanted a relationship with the son that went out and blew it. If you don't think I blow it, I'll give him the number to my wife. Amen. She knows my faults alphabetically. And she can recite them backwards. So I know I failed. I'm not perfect. I don't claim to be. But he restored me. And if he restored me, I know he can restore you. I know he can. And then you've got the self-righteous group that think that they're all that in a bag of chips. Honey, let me tell you what. I don't know what's happening. That's okay. You might think that you're all that, but I got news for you. Jesus isn't impressed by you, but he loves you, and he wants a relationship with you. I know people that I've told them many times, I said, I would love to buy you for what you're worth and sell you for what you think you're worth. I'd retire tomorrow. But you are special. You were worth the blood of Jesus Christ. He wants to restore you today. He wants that relationship with you. That's what he paid for. And I think it's good that everybody's here at church this morning. And after start talking to people about the Lord, and you ask them, well, have you ever received Jesus Christ as your Savior? And the first thing they say, well, I'm a member of so-and-so-and-so-and-so. Try it sometime. See if you don't get that answer. Honey, when they talk about the roll being called up yonder in that song that we sing, they're not talking about a church roll. They're talking about a roll of the redeemed, the people that are in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you have received Christ as your personal Savior, your name is in that book, amen? And that's the role that we're talking about, not a church role. A lot of people say, well, I go to church, I'm a Christian.
coming to the church house does not make you a Christian. The righteous blood of Jesus Christ and that applied to your sinful life is what atones you and what purchases you and what buys you. And today I hope that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus is your righteousness. The only righteousness I have is Jesus. He's the only reason I'm restored today. It's because of His blood. And I can come to the Father as a son talking to as a child talking to a father because of the righteous, redemptive work, blood of Jesus Christ and the work that He has finished and done, not my own. Today, what are we trusting in? What are we hoping on? What are you depending on today? I need to wrap this up. I only got 2 more hours to go. Y'all pray for me. This parable reveals our Heavenly Father's mercy, grace, and desire for a relationship. And like I said, 2 guys were lost in their own way. One in self-righteousness, the other one in self-indulgence. The younger son represented the publicans and sinners. The older son represented the scribes and the Pharisees, who were good at keeping the law and at pointing people out that didn't keep the law. But what they did, they failed to understand what the purpose of the law was. There was no genuine love for the Lord. The scribes and the Pharisees understood the workings of the law, but they failed to understand that at its core, the law was about relationships and love. It revolved around loving God and loving people. That's why Jesus said that all the laws of the prophet hung on 2 commandments. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is likened to it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Thank you. It's all about love, folks. It's all about love. If Jesus is in your heart, He'll supply the love. He'll supply the love. That's the only time that our actions mean anything, is if they're motivated out of love. You might be here this morning and you're motivated by your obligation. You might be motivated by what people might think of you if you're not here. You might be motivated by fear today, thinking that, okay, somebody's going to talk about me if I'm there. But today I hope that you got it motivated by love. There's 2 types of people. The people that say, I got to go to church. How many know them people? I got to go to church. And then there's the folks that say, I get to go to church. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I love y'all signs at the entrances. We're glad it's Sunday. This is the Lord's day. We get to come in and worship Him today. Amen? Together, collectively. What is your motivation this morning for serving Jesus? If it's not motivated by love, then maybe we need to check up. And maybe we need to do some soul searching and see if we've ever entered into a relationship with Him. May we seek to live in a balance between these 2 extremes represented by these 2 sons. May we be wholly dependent upon the Lord Jesus Christ and forever thankful of Him forgiving us and drawing us into a relationship with Him. And yet, the example of the older son, may we obey Him and may we do His work motivated by love and not duty. Amen? Amen. What's our motivation this morning? What's our motivation? You fall in 1 of 2 categories today. You're 1 of 2 categories today. Either you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, or you have not. And if you have not today, I want you to know you're a very special guest this morning. We're so glad you're here. Because in just a minute, I'm going to give you an invitation to accept Jesus as your Savior. And I'm not going to come to you. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way, shape, form, or fashion. But I'm just going to ask you to just be honest with me. When everybody bows their head and closes their eyes, and whenever whenever I give that part of the service and nobody's looking around. But thank God for those of us that are redeemed by the grace of God. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you, Lord, that no matter what our past was, you love us. You cared for us. You bled for us. You died for us. But on that third day, you rose again for our righteousness and our redemption. Thank you that you defeated death, hell, and the grave. Thank you, Jesus, that you are above all things and before all things. And by you all things consist. We thank you, Father, for all the mercy and the grace and the love that you bestowed upon us. Help us, Lord, to bestow that love